Hello, my name is Anna Weissmeyer. I use she, her pronouns, and I'm a white female with medium length brown hair and purple streaks. I'm the accessibility research lead on the Xbox research team. Okay, let's get started talking about accessibility and disability, and hopefully give everyone some new insights into how we think about accessibility. The World Health Organization reports that over 1 billion people in the world have some type of disability. That's about 15% of the world's population, or between 1 in 7 and 1 in 8 people. In the United States, the number is closer to 20%. That's about 1 in 5 people. Focused specifically on gaming, there are about 3 billion gamers in the world. And if we extrapolate from the numbers I mentioned before, that means that around 450 million of those gamers worldwide have some kind of disability. This is a huge number of people that we might be missing if we are not designing our games with accessibility and inclusion in mind. So, we've established that there are millions of gamers that we might miss if we don't think broadly about our audience, challenge our assumptions, and make our games more inclusive. But how do we approach inclusivity and accessibility in gaming? Well, to bridge that gap, we use the inclusive design approach that was developed by Microsoft Design after hundreds of hours of research with many people from diverse backgrounds. It can be applied to inclusion more broadly across many different dimensions: race, gender, LGBTQ identity, nationality, socioeconomic status, and more. Today, we're going to explore how to apply them to disability and accessibility. Using the inclusive design approach means drawing on the full range of human diversity and working directly with players to understand their lived experiences and learn from them. Microsoft has 3 inclusive design principles that guide this approach. The first is to recognize exclusion. This is about recognizing that we all solve problems using our own biases. In order to be truly inclusive, we have to recognize where we may be unintentionally excluding people through our bias. The second principle is to learn from diversity, which is exactly what this workshop is about. Our players with disabilities are experts on their own lives. We want to learn from them about their needs and their delights. And the third principle is solve for one, extend to many. Accessible design is inclusive design. And so many accessibility features are used by far more people than we'd otherwise expect. And they make the experience better overall for everyone. All of these principles are in place to remind us of an old design axiom: you are not the user. We're going to go through each one of these principles in a little more detail to shift our thinking and set the tone for the rest of the workshop. We'll start with recognizing exclusion, and we'll use an example to illustrate this principle. But first, let's go over the social model of disability. This is a model I'd like you all to keep in mind during the workshop. This model thinks about disability not as a personal health condition, but instead as mismatched human interactions. This photo is a scene from an episode of Drunk History, featuring disabled comedian and author Zach Anner. And I have a question for you all to consider. In this picture, what do you think the disability is? When asked this question, many people respond with the name of a medical condition affecting mobility, such as paralysis or cerebral palsy. Some folks are familiar with the prevalence of invisible disabilities, such as mental health conditions, and respond with depression or anxiety. However, today, what I'd like you to consider is that the disability is the stairs. Think about it. If we all used wheelchairs to move around, we wouldn't build stairs. We'd build elevators or ramps or other kinds of ways to get in and around our built environment. But this building, just like so much in our built environment and our lives in general, was likely designed and created by people without disabilities, with the assumption that everyone who entered would be able to use the stairs. So this leads us to the social model of disability. Viewing disability not as an inherent characteristic of a person or people, but rather as a mismatch between the person and their environment. Now, let's get into a gaming-related example. Standard gaming controllers are generally designed with a lot of assumptions about how they will be used by players. It's assumed that the user can use two hands and two thumbs for the sticks. It's also assumed that people have the fine motor control to hit all the buttons, sometimes simultaneously. It's also assumed that people can hold the controller for an extended period of time. But we know that not all of our players can or want to use a standard controller in those ways. These are all mismatches that are unintentionally built into the design of a standard controller. By recognizing these unintentional exclusions, we can begin to think about accessibility. Accessibility is the correction of these mismatches. It's removing the barriers to fun or life so that everyone can participate. The next inclusive design principle is to learn from diversity. Earlier, I told you that about 20% of the US population are people with disabilities. These are players who are already in the ecosystem of gaming. They're here, playing games, working around the mismatches that we may have unintentionally designed into games. We can learn a lot from the adaptations and workarounds that players have invented in order to play games, and use those learnings to think about how we might design some solutions ourselves. The third inclusive design principle is solving for one and extending to many. Once we recognize exclusion and learn from the diversity of our players, we can begin designing some solutions that can help solve some of the mismatches that we learn about. Often, we're going to be designing these solutions just after talking to a few players. And although it may seem counterintuitive, designing for a specific person with a distinct need can inspire product ideas you might not have imagined. And it helps us build things that will help many more people than we'd expect. Of course, there are many people with permanent disabilities, like people with blindness, or people who are deaf, or people who are missing a limb. However, if we think about the social model of disability, those aren't the only people with disabilities. There are also many more people with temporary disabilities, like temporary hearing loss after an ear infection, or a broken arm, or a cataract in their eye. Then, there are even more people with what we call situational disabilities, like people who are in a loud space like a bar, or a new parent with only one hand free, or a distracted driver. In turn, accessibility features that may have been designed for someone with a permanent disability can also help people with temporary and situational disabilities, and maybe with other needs. When you think of disability as a mismatch between a person and their environment, you're able to see the mismatches as a part of the interaction between a user and a product, rather than something inherent to specific users. For example, closed captioning was originally designed for people who are deaf or hard of hearing, so that they can follow along with spoken language and sound effects. However, there are many other people who use closed captions, like folks who are in a noisy environment, like an airport, or people who are teaching their children to read. One example of this is the Xbox Copilot feature. Copilot is a feature where a user can set two controllers to act as one on the system. Xbox created this feature primarily to help people with disabilities create custom controller rigs and configurations to play their games. On the screen are some photos that Special Effect, a gaming charity supporting the physically disabled, shared of custom controllers they made for people before the Copilot feature existed. And prior to the introduction of the Copilot, nonprofit groups like Special Effect had to physically crack open the Xbox controllers and wire them together in order to make custom controllers and gameplay setups. Those who were involved in the creation of the Copilot feature were particularly inspired by these photos and people who use similar gaming setups. But they saw early on that Copilot could also be used for something else. the Copilot feature could be used by parents as training wheels for gaming. If a parent has a child who wants to play a game, but maybe doesn't have the fine motor control necessary to navigate around in the game, parents can actually use the Copilot feature to give their child one or a few controls to handle while the parent navigates the tricky parts. This is one of the ways that Copilot was actually marketed to customers, as an accessibility feature and as a way for parents and children to play together. As Phil Spencer has said in the past, the results of inclusive design for accessibility always lead to a better product for everyone. It's important for us to include people with disabilities from the very beginning of the planning process so that this can be a proactive part of your design approach. The inclusive design approach also reinforces the role of people without disabilities as strong allies and partners who share the role towards inclusivity and accessibility. In sum, accessible design is about designing without or designing to remove the unintentional mismatches between people and the environment that we have created through our designs. Inclusive design means intentionally recognizing when exclusion is happening, learning from the diversity of people's experiences and solutions, and knowing that by solving for one use case, we can benefit many more. With these tools in our tool belt, let's prepare for your interviews. Okay, first and likely foremost, you'll be talking to players with disabilities. And yes, it's okay, in fact, it's preferred for you to use the word disability. It's not scary and it's not bad. Don't feel the need to use other terms like differently abled. If the person you're speaking with uses a different term, feel free to mirror their language, but otherwise, stick to using disability. Another thing to consider is that identifying exclusion through a specific medical diagnosis is usually not helpful when designing. For example, sharing an ADHD diagnosis with a designer is not as useful as sharing a specific mismatch around concentration and the need for an isolated and quiet environment with little stimulus. In addition to using the word disability and focusing on people's experiences rather than their medical diagnoses, you're probably going to want to think about what language you might use. People first language puts the person before the disability and describes what a person has, not who a person is. For example, a journalist with a visual disability or an engineer with autism. In contrast, identity first language is when the disability is placed before the name of the person or their identifier. For example, a person with a disability may say, "I'm a disabled journalist," or "I'm an autistic engineer." Respect a person's right to choose the language that they feel most comfortable with. The language people choose to use to identify and represent themselves is a personal choice and must be respected. And remember, you're probably going to mess up. Nobody's perfect, and learning takes time. But it's going to be okay. If you do make a mistake, just apologize and correct yourself. For example, the term hearing impaired can be problematic for some folks in the deaf and hard of hearing community. So if you use the term hearing impaired, just say, "Oh, sorry, I meant people who are deaf or hard of hearing," and then move on. And if you're unsure, it's okay to ask what you should say or do instead. Just remember, keep going and don't dwell on the mistake. I want to thank you for taking the time to listen to me today, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the workshop.